ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। श्री भगवानुवाच, अनाश्रितः कर्मफलम् कार्यं कर्म करोति यः, स सन्न्यासी च योगी च, न निरग्निर्न चाक्रियः। द सुप्रीम पर्सनालिटी ऑफ गॉड हैड सेड, वन हु इज अनअटैच्ड टू द फ्रूट्स ऑफ हिज वर्क, अनाश्रितः कर्मफलम्, एंड हु वर्क्स एज ही इज ऑब्लिगेटेड, कार्यम कर्म करोति, is in the renounced order of life, sa sannyasi, and he is the true mystic, yogi cha, not he who lights no fire, niragni, and performs no duty, akriyaha. Hare Krishna. So we welcome everyone for studying Bhagavad Gita. We are about to begin the actual chapter. We last time saw the overview of the Panchakosha and how it fits in the Ashtanga Yoga and in the Bhakti Yoga context. So today we are beginning with the first. So we saw that there are these qualities of the soul, and when we start appreciating they exist, and we are sinless, ageless, deathless, without hunger, thirst, grief, we are always blissful, we have ability to fulfill all one's desires. That's called Brahma Bhuta stage. So this was very much glorified in the previous chapter. Now we have the overview of this one. So 1 through 9 is prerequisites for meditation. So there is yoga in practice and yoga in perfection. Aruruksu, yoga in practice. 1 through 6. Arudha, perfected in yoga practice, Ashtanga Yoga. Text 7 through 9. Then 10 through 7, 27 is basic practices of Ashtanga Yoga leading to Samadhi. Then there is finally super soul realization, Paramatma Sakshatkar, through Ashtanga Yoga. What does one feel like? How does one behave at that stage? 28 through 32. Then 33 through 45, Arjuna's doubts about Ashtanga Yoga. What happens to an unsuccessful yogi? This path seems too tedious, impossible of practice, especially for a worldly person. And last 46, 47, the conclusion. The topmost yogi is a bhakta. So hinting to the next section, beginning with chapter 7, the bhakti section of Bhagavad Gita. That's how the first six chapters conclusion is that bhakti is best. So this we saw last time, science of consciousness. And I hope whenever you are in any of these stages, you have started realizing yourself that my system is currently working in Annamaya platform or it is working at Pranamaya platform. How many of you noticed this? You notice? That's beginning of self-realization. If you don't notice these things, then you are far from self-realization. We will try and cover today at least till 27. So stay tight as we go through the verses. So beginning with this one, Anashritaha Karma Phalam. What is sannyasa? Who knows? Sat nyasa. What does that mean? Keeping mind under control? No. Sat nyasa. Nyasa means to give up the results of one's work for the sake of absolute truth, sat. That's called sannyasa. So one who gives up the fruits of one's work is sannyasi. And what is a yogi? Yogi is someone who works diligently on purifying one's heart by not allowing mind to dwell on sense objects. Yogaha chittavritti nirodhaha. Chittavritti means thought waves. They arise in the heart because of contact with varieties of material sense objects and contemplation on them. Dhyayato Vishayan. So one who is constantly working on that level to not dwell on sense objects and is trying to do Nirodha of Chitta Vritti. He is called a yogi. So Krishna is saying in this verse, Sa Sannyasi Cha Yogi Cha. He is putting all of them in the same cadre. A person who merely renounces actions such as the fire sacrifice, Agnihotra, he is not called Sannyasi. That is Niragni. Nor is one who merely half closes his eyes without external body activity. Like sometimes we do this, that we get so fed up with the material world, we go in some place and we do meditation. And the meditation is on nothing. People sit and they try to be oblivious to the surroundings. This is called Akriyaha. Now this Akriyaha and that Niragni, one who gave up the Vedic formularies of Agnihotra, they may appear as if Sannyasi and Yogi. You get that? So Krishna is saying those fellows are not doing exactly the job of Sannyasi and Yogi. Who are doing? So, Anashritaha Karma Phalam Karyam Karma Karoti. Without becoming attached to the fruits of one's work, not sheltering oneself, that if I get those fruits then I will work, and if I don't get those fruits I will not work. That is Ashritaha Karma Phalam. Anashritaha. And Karyam Karma. I am doing this service or this activity because that's my duty. Karyam Karma. So such a mood is called Sa Sannyasi Sa Yogi Cha. So the connection is, one should not give up Nishkam Karma Yoga suddenly thinking that I have now become Ashtang Yogi. One should be doubly sure that I have accomplished getting rid of Chitta Vrittis that arise out of sense contact, and I have become accomplished in the art of not taking shelter of the fruits of my work. How many of you feel terrified when you lose your HDFC or ICICI bank card? Ashritaha Karma Phalam. So you may say, but Prabhu, that's natural. No, that's Krishna's money, Prabhuji. Meant to be used in devotional service. You know. Really? So this is the point. Nishkam Karma Yoga has very different consideration, very different consciousness. So yogi is one who practices not allowing mind to dwell on sense objects. Sannyasi is someone who gives up the fruits of his work for the sake of the Supreme. And in this way, we have to practice this in our life, especially at our stage, because we have not even begun Nishkam Karma Yoga in proper practice. So this is where we begin. So Prabhupada gives in the first paragraph in this chapter what is going to happen. But you can read it at home. And then towards the end of the purport, Prabhupada proves how a Krishna conscious person is both sannyasi and yogi. So he is sannyasi because na dhanam na janam na sundarim kavitam va jagadisha kamaye. In this way he is doing chitta vritti nirodha. He is avoiding those things that disrupt our consciousness and make it fall away from meditation on Supreme. Mama janmani janmani ishvare bhavatad bhaktir ahaituki tvai. Ahaituki, that word indicates that he has anashritaha karma phalam. He has no desires for fruitive gain. So Prabhupada says that a bhakti yogi is simultaneously a sannyasi and a yogi. Far better than any of the accomplished nishkam karma yogis and the accomplished ashtang yogis. That's his case building that he's doing right in the first paragraph. Abhi tak chapter shuru bhi nahi hua hai. I keep saying this, Prabhupada, you know, Krishna is about to blow the balloon of some particular Jnana Yoga, you know, Ashtanga Yoga. And Prabhupada in the first purport only puts a pin inside. Poop. And I say, what happened? Huh? Why this Swamiji is so cruel? You know? But no, he's not cruel. He's actually exactly doing the thing that we need at our stage. Because we read this verse and that's all maybe probably what we read. Then we are going to think I am supposed to do this Agnihotra continued or something like that. So that's why. So you get the connection between how bhakti yogi is both sannyasi and a yogi. Practical example, those six people who went to London. Prabhupada sent them from Amsterdam to London and they had really no karma phala to be taken shelter of because they didn't have even money. They used to show $1,000 in the bank, which they had borrowed from some people, their friends and hippies. and one person would cross over and go from US to London and then send the money by wire. Then another person would show that money in the account to the immigration, go there, again send the money by wire. And like that, all those six fellows went. And the money remained here only. So they had no money when they reached there. Can you imagine? You go to a new country to start preaching Krishna consciousness. Anashritaha karma phalam. You know. And what was their chitta vritti nirodha? Even in the midst of contact with personalities like George Harrison and his fans who were addicted to sense gratification, they continued the mission of Prabhupada. It's not easy. If you get some big shot contact to cultivate in Krishna consciousness, be careful. Good luck. You can actually get more diverted from your focus than just being a good devotee. So they were chitta vritti nirodha, natural, because they are fixed in the instruction of Prabhupada that they wanted to follow. So thus na dhanam na janam na sun, they could actually live by this. So this is the proof that bhakti yogi is included with all these practices. Second verse. Yam sanyasamiti prahur yogam tam vidhi pandava nahya sanyasta sankalpo yogi bhavati kashchana.
What is called renunciation you should know to be the same as yoga, or linking oneself with the Supreme. O son of Pandu, for one can never become a yogi unless he renounces the desire for sense gratification.
So unless one has given up the desire for sense gratification, he cannot be a sannyasi. Just like yoga is meant for giving up the desire for sense gratification. So they are considered synonymous here. So yam sannyasam, what is known as sannyasa, iti prahuhu, yogam tam vidhi, is same as yoga. And asanyasta sankalpa means one who has not given up the desire to enjoy senses. Such a person cannot become yogi. Na yogi bhavati. Such a person cannot become a yogi. Middle of the purport. Yogis restrain senses from material attachment. But a person in Krishna consciousness has no opportunity to engage in senses in anything which is not for the purpose of Krishna. Therefore, a Krishna conscious person is simultaneously a sannyasi and a yogi. You have seen this in Janmashtami time. So much service is there. You know, people are fasting additionally. And they have this, like I remember, I was manager in Kunjibihari temple. And somehow in the planning, the kitchen fellows forgot that if the cylinder truck comes, how will the cylinders reach from outside to inside? That was one thing that we missed out. So you can't get in through the pandal, you know, breaking everything and go there. And then they started shouting and yelling, Prabhu, cylinder transfer karna hai, cylinder transfer karna hai. You know, from that location to kitchen. And you need volunteers now suddenly. And why? Because kitchen, you know, RB runs on its belly, okay? If no prasad, everything goes havoc. So they said, so we put 2-3 devotees and we started transferring the cylinders. And one devotee came in between. That devotee was carrying cylinder. And he was giving him another service. Because he had his own department also. He was supposed to do something on the stall or something. And that devotee shouted, Prabhu, marne ke liye time nahi hai. And I was hearing that. I said, excellent. Prabhupada said here, a person Krishna has no opportunity to engage his senses in anything which is not for the purpose of Krishna. You know. So, baad mein aata hu. Cylinder dal ke aata hu. Last 5-6 lines. The real aim is for a living entity to give up all selfish satisfaction and be prepared to satisfy the Supreme. One who has no information of the Supreme must engage in self-satisfaction, because no one can stand on the platform of inactivity. How many of you tried inactivity in life? You know this vipassana? It's a... Huh? sleeping also activity is going on inside psychic activity is going on, physical activity has stopped. In fact, that is a double activity. You know, the way our mind works, engine is on all the time. Arurukshor munair yogam karma karanam uchyate yogarudhasya tasyaiva shamah karanam uchyate.
For one who is a devotee in the eightfold yoga system, work is said to be the means. And for one who is already elevated in yoga, cessation of all material activities is said to be the means.
So we saw this already. Arudha Arurukshu. So neophyte is called Arurukshu. And accomplished fellow is called Yoga Arudha. In the first paragraph, second last line, the beginning of the ladder, of yoga ladder, is called Yoga Arurukshu stage. The highest rung is called Yoga Arudha. You remember yoga ladder? We have done a million times. Not only in the Bhakti Shastri class, in our lifetimes in the past. We have gone up and down that yoga ladder many times. So he says, there is Yoga Arurukshu and there is Yoga Arudha. Now, concerning the Eightfold Yoga system, attempts in the beginning to enter into meditation through regulative principles of life and practice of different sitting postures. Actually, principles of life is pranayam, regulative principles of life, and practice of different sitting postures is asana. They are considered fruitive material activities, which means Ashtanga Yoga becomes spiritual only at the stage of kind of samadhi. All these stages that are in between are on material plane only, because you are still dealing with the material body, how you are breathing, how, you know, so all the systems in the material body are being taken care of. All such activities lead to achieving perfect mental equilibrium to control the senses. When one is accomplished in the practice of meditation, dhyana, he ceases all disturbing mental activities, chitta vritti nirodhaha. Now again, a Krishna conscious person comes there. He is everywhere, by the way, in the Bhagavad Gita. But he again comes. He is situated from the beginning on the platform of meditation, dhyana. Why? Because he is always thinking of Krishna. Being constantly engaged in service of Krishna, he has already ceased all material activities. Dekha? So simple. So similarly, in our Bhakti Yoga, there are two stages. There is Bhakti Yoga Arurukshu, Sadhana Bhakti, Vaidhi Sadhana, Raga Nuga Sadhana. And then there is Yoga Arudha. What is that? Bhava Bhakti, Prema Bhakti. So, in the beginning stages, Karma Karanam Uchyate, we have to focus on the devotional service that we are performing. And Arudha, it becomes natural for us to think of Krishna always, no matter what activity is going on. So today only one devotee was asking, when I am doing toilet bathroom cleaning in the ashram, I am also playing a lecture or a kirtan. So is that a good idea? Because, you know, the discussion had come that we have to give up multitasking and do one thing that we are doing right now nicely. It's a principle. So he asked, so can't we do two, three things nicely like this? So the answer was, we are Yoga Arurukshu. We are not yet accomplished in this thing, that we can simultaneously do Nama, Rupa, Guna and Leela participation. For us, current Leela is toilet bathroom cleaning. We are participating Krishna Leela. You may not believe that, but that's the fact. That you are directly engaging in Lord's service by cleaning that toilet bathroom. It's a participation in Leela. We don't think like that, but that's the fact. And that Leela has to be accompanied by chanting of the holy names, Nama, meditation on the Rupa, form of the Lord and also Guna, qualities of the Lord. So for us, it is very difficult to do all this. It's like, you know, somebody is told, okay, sit straight, look straight, hold the steering, change the gear, show hand. I say, bhai, ek hi bolo bhai, sab kaise karne ka? So he's Arurukshu, driver. Yoga Arudha. Somebody who is accomplished in driving, he does all these 15 things and he gives galis also to some people on the road
and you know has many other multitasking that he accomplished. You know, because you know Arudh, you know, accomplished in that art of driving. दिखता नहीं गया तेरे को कट मारता गया ऐसे यू नो पीपल आर डूइंग ऑल काइंड ऑफ थिंग्स सो इन द बिगिनिंग व्हेन वी आर नियोफाइट्स वी नीड नॉट प्ले लेक्चर्स अराउंड वी शुड रादर दैट्स नॉट स्टडी टाइम दैट्स कॉन्टेम्पलेशन टाइम सो व्हाट एवर वी हैव स्टडीड वी हैव टू थिंक व्हाइल डूइंग टॉयलेट बाथरूम क्लीनिंग व्हाट वेयर इज माई कॉन्शियसनेस गोइंग व्हाट हैव आई हर्ड What am I applying? What am I failing to apply? How can I rectify? This is what you do. Mananam. And that is what... And also you have to see if the thought process is not going in positive direction, is going here and there. Then you have to bring that back and put it into proper direction. It's a practice. If you simply eat, eat, eat and don't give time for digestion, it's not good. So best would be... to focus on the activity that we are doing very nicely and do it with full absorption and gradually the other things will also come in that activity just like we say we chant nama just here then what will happen eventually rupa guna and leela will follow similarly service leela just do it that one thing nicely other things will come there as you progress in the path So I hope I am not confusing anyone. You can start practicing tomorrow. Maybe today night while sleeping that this sleeping is a leela. I am participating in Krishna's, you know. Why sleeping is a leela? Because I am recuperating my energy to serve the next day. So how can I nicely sleep today? So full absorption. And then you wake up, you know, when the alarm rings, you know, you should look at the alarm with a glance of great love that this alarm is helping me to engage in devotional service early morning you know then when you take your beads in hand you start chanting you should look at your beads with love feedback with love and whichever atmosphere you try start chanting in should be greatly relishing the very opportunity to be absorbed in the nama and this is yoga aruruksu practice As we go ahead with this, everything becomes spontaneous. Multitasking is allowed at that time. Yeah, artificially, really, naturally, we have to do the right thing. Sometimes we say, no, I don't feel like. So who cares what you feel like? We care what Krishna feels like about what you are doing. So, but I feel, but I don't feel. So one time one devotee went to spiritual master, Maharaj, any instructions? Come out of your mental platform and be situated on devotional platform. And he was like, he was really off the head, you know, when they asked that question. And got such a solid instruction. That's the instruction. Ki stop hovering on the mental platform. Get real, as they call it in what, movies, you know. Get real. So let's begin bhakti in that. Hearing Bhagavatam during deity worship, is it allowed? If what you are hearing is facilitating your contemplation on the activity of your service. See, it is not that devotees can't do two things, three things together. We are not saying that. But we have to see what we are doing. Is it happening with the due quota of mindfulness in that activity? But why do you think that deity worship with full concentration won't purify you enough? That you have to additionally have 3-4 other booster engines, you know. Like you know, Dhruva Maharaj, he chanted Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, he did Pancharatrika worship of the deity of Krishna and he had Ashtanga Yoga that he practiced. Like a triple booster rocket launch, you know. To take the consciousness of matter. So, We can take help of those activities. But sometimes, our problem is, at the end of the story, if we ask, okay, what did you hear today? Hey, that only Maharaj knows what he spoke. You know, we don't know much. And same with the deity worship. Did the deities feel that you are fully attending to them? Their feeling matters, right? So they, you go and ask the deities. So well, how was this pujari today? They said tenga. He was, you know, God knows what he was doing. Twice he, you know, pricked me. You know, he did something else and he pulled off my hair without being conscious that they are not just some bunch of, you know, sticked, you know, artificial thing. So many things that happen. You know, he removed my flute so harshly. My hands are paining. You know. Do you believe that Krishna is there and he has feelings? So then, there are many things like this. So again, I am not discouraging multitasking. If you are really accomplished at it, fine. You are maybe that driver, you know, who does multi things, you know, while driving a vehicle. I am not saying you don't. But you see what you are doing and where is it leading you to. It's very important to do the right thing and become the right person. What we are becoming in the process. Text 4.
Yada henendriyartesho na karmasu anushajyate sarvasankalpa sanyasi yoga rudhastadochyate.
A person is said to be elevated in yoga when, having renounced all material desires, he neither acts for sense gratification or engages in fruitive activities.
So who is called a yoga arudha is defined in that verse. And that Krishna conscious person again comes there, in the purport. Text 5. Uddharedatmanatmanam natmanam avasadayet atmaivayatmano bandhu atmaivari puratmanaha.
One must deliver himself with the help of his mind and not degrade himself. The mind is the friend of the conditioned soul and his enemy as well.
So, Prabhupada begins by first clarifying the dictionary meaning. Atma means what? Atma means body. Atma jaya suta gara pashudravena bandhushu. How Bharat Maharaj gave up his body also, Atma. Then, Atma means mind in certain contexts in Sanskrit. And then, Atma also means soul. So, depending on different circumstances. So, typically, if you read a commentary on the Gita, on this verse, they say, apanach apla shatru ani apanach apla mitra. Atma ivahi atmano bandhu. Atmaivari puratmanaha. So, that's not the meaning. Soul has to be delivered with the help of the mind. And soul should not be degraded because of the activities of the mind. So, that's why that word atmanam or atma has those two contexts. So, the whole yoga practice is all about one line. Mind must be so trained, 6th, 7th line, that it can deliver the conditioned soul from the mire of nations. Next few lines later. Mind should be trained so that it will not be attracted to the glitter of material nature. Thus the conditioned soul may be saved. So this is a beautiful verse. Mana eva manushyanam karanam bandha mokshayoho. Bandhaya Vishaya Sango. Mind causes bondage when it gets attached to Vishaya, sense objects. Muktyai Nirvishayam Manaha. And it leads to liberation when it becomes freed from attachment to sense objects. So whole modern culture is based on creating attraction for sense objects. Everywhere you go, billboards. Nowadays they don't keep quiet. Even in your pocket they make advertisements, you know, with the mobile that you have. Targeted advertisements. Because whatever you contemplated earlier on the Google in search, the Google has the exact, you know, attractive feature made available at a discounted price, you know, right in your pocket. So this is called Bandhaya Vishaya Sanga. So why should we become very aware of the mind's dealings?
Bandhuratmatmanastasya yenatmaivatmanajitaha anatmanastu shatrutve vartetatmaiva shatruvat.
For him who has conquered the mind is the best of friends, but for one who has failed to do so, his mind will remain the greatest enemy.
Third line, unless the mind is controlled, the practice of yoga for show is simply a waste of time. One who cannot control his mind lives always with the greatest enemy, and thus his life and its mission are spoiled. Last four lines, real yoga practice entails meeting with the Paramatma within the heart and then following his dictation. And then Krishna conscious person comes there again. For one who takes to Krishna consciousness directly, perfect surrender to the dictation of the Lord follows automatically.
Guru Mukha Padma Vakya Chitte Te Kari Aikya Ar Na Kari Ha Mane Asha.
So this was Aruruksu. Aruruksu has to be very careful with the mind and constantly work on making it friendly, not inimical, by taking its contemplation away from sense objects and providing the right type of contemplation. So now comes Arudha, Arudh Prabhu.
Jitatmanaha prashantasya paramatma samahitaha shitoshna sukha dukkhesho tatha manapamana yoho.
For one who has conquered the mind, the super soul is already reached, and for he has attained tranquility. To such a man, happiness and distress, heat and cold, honor and dishonor are all the same.
Seventh line, one has to abide by superior dictation. That dictation word repeats a lot in this. When one's mind is fixed on superior nature, he has no alternative but to follow the dictation of the Supreme. The mind must admit to some superior dictation and follow it. The effect, one automatically follows the dictation of Paramatma. So one time His Holiness Radhanath Maharaj was asked by Radhesham Prabhu, how can I make perfect decisions as a leader, especially when devotees are asking me for big choices that they have to make, you know, join ashram or not, go abroad or not, do this service or not. So Maharaj told, to the degree you follow the small instructions that I have given you nicely, to that degree you will be inspired by Paramatma to make the big decisions properly. So one has to accept superior dictation and follow. Last three lines. So that Krishna conscious person is coming in the purport. The devotee is unaffected by the dualities. This state is practical samadhi, absorption in the Supreme. How many of you read this Salted Bread? You don't know this book, Salted Bread? Homework, read Salted Bread. It's a story of a Russian devotee. Shanti, what is his name? Ananta Shanti Prabhu. A practical explanation of this verse, that story. Correct. So we are given check and balance through Guru Sadhu Shastra. So we get some inspiration, intuition. We go and check it out. What does Shastra say about this? What do my peers think of this? What does my Guru tell me about it? And then do it. Premonition. Yeah, these are factual things. Clairvoyance, premonition, ESP, extrasensory perception. And especially they happen in relationships that are deep. One gets those kind of... it can be a material phenomenon also. It's not necessarily like something transcendental. In our context, it depends on the relationship that we share with the person, how spiritual it is. Also, how spiritual is our relationship with Krishna. Our current relationship is material relationship. You know, we treat Krishna as a supplier for our sense gratification. So accordingly, the visions and premonitions and everything, dreams, they become spiritual.
Jnana vidjnana truptatma kutastho vijitendriyaha yukta ityuchyate yogi samaloshtrashmakanchanaha.
A person is said to be established in self-realization and is called a yogi or mystic when he is fully satisfied by virtue of acquired knowledge and realization. Such a person is situated in transcendence and is self-controlled. He sees everything, whether it be pebbles, stones or gold, as the same.
How many of you think like this? Then you will become yoga rudha when you think like that.
So jnana vidjnana truptatma, he who is satisfied by scriptural teachings and realizations that he has, is called jnana vidjnana truptatma. How many of you feel satisfied when you hear scriptural teachings? How many of you feel satisfied when you get some realizations once in a while, in heart? So this is, you have some experience. So jnana vidjnana truptatma. Then kutastha. Kutastha means who is pervaded by only spiritual nature, within and without. Very fixed in spiritual life. No double existence. Kutastha, in other places, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur says, fixed like an anvil. You have seen this press machines, bench press. Uska anvil dekha hai kabhi? It's so fixed. You just can't do anything with it moving. It's called kutastha. So like that devotee is very fixed, or Ashtanga Yogi is very fixed. Then Vijitendriyaha, such a person is called Yukta, properly situated in yoga. And the first symptom, Samaloshtra Ashma Kanchanaha, he sees everything, pebbles, stone, gold as the same. So Prabhupada gives a clue how to develop Vijnana in the first part. Ata Sri Krishna Namadi na bhavet grahyam indriyaihi. Sevon mukhehi jihvadau swayameva spurati adaha. Book knowledge is useless. No one can understand transcendental nature of Krishna through his materially contaminated senses. Only when one becomes spiritually saturated by transcendental service are Nama Rupa Guna Leela revealed. So jnana becomes vijnana. Theoretical knowledge, scriptural knowledge becomes realized knowledge. So don't go for mundane scholarship. Associate with persons who is in pure consciousness. Satisfy Krishna and a Krishna conscious person with pure devotional service that you render. Thus get grace of Krishna in life and thus become perfect. So these are the steps. And then again one more time, dhulai of mundane scholarship. Devotee is transcendental because he has nothing to do with mundane scholarship. For him, mundane scholarship and mental speculation, which may be as good as gold to others, are of no greater value than pebbles or stones. So this is actually, this last line is supposed to be also connected to the next verse, because that's more subtler verse than this one. Prabhupada is making a point that not only you treat samaloshtra ashma kanchana, he is saying you treat scholarship also, mundane scholarship also, like pebbles and stones. No value. Now comes a subtler version. This is more difficult to have as a realization. Surun mitrari udasinam madhyastha dvesha bandhushu sadhushvapi cha papeshu samabuddhir vishishyate.
A person is considered still further advanced when he regards honest well-wishers, affectionate benefactors, the neutral mediators, the envious, friends and enemies, the pious and the sinners, all with an equal mind.
So we all have this varieties of relationships, and we tend to categorize them immediately. Surut, heart-to-heart friend. Mitra, acquaintance. Kari, enemy. Udasina, no interest in me. I have no interest in him. Madhyastha, he is helpful for resolving my conflicts if they happen. Dveshi, this fellow is envious of me. And Bandushu, he is my bodily relationship, kinsman. And then Sadhu, very gentlemanly person. Papi, sinner. And in this way, we immediately tend to categorize. As soon as we come across few people, even in the beginning of the relationship, just the conversation has not even begun. Even the appearance of the person or his glance or something, we have already made a decision. What it is. So this yogi Arudha Samabuddhir Vishishyate. Vishishta. What is his speciality? He has no such vision of people around him. What a powerful consciousness, you can imagine. So he thinks, what does he think? He doesn't think in terms of these categories. He sees them in terms of their constitutional nature, which is spiritual. So there are two visions we can develop. Ye atma hai, lekin papi hai. Or, ye papi hai, lekin atma hai. So, and accordingly, then our entire reciprocation changes with those people. So, we generally have created a havoc by our dealings in people relationships because of this categorization. And we can set it right by to the degree we start at least appreciating the spiritual side of their personality. Now from 10th onwards begins the discussion on basic practices of Ashtanga Yoga leading to Samadhi. Question. So that depends on two things. What is the content and how we are going to use it in devotional service? And what is the context in which that knowledge is going to get applied? For example, using iPad. So, sometimes you have to study the machine to make it work. You know, you studied the content. So, I may become a expert iPad user. But for what purpose? How am I using it in devotional service? And then context, which refers to, or rather experience, let's call it. When I'm using it, what experience am I creating for myself and others? How elevated they are becoming in their consciousness. So now replace iPad with scholarship, mundane scholarship. So people learn about, you know, how to increase the longevity of a soap bubble. They do research, you know, they spend 10 years doing PhD in that. Okay, so where is that soap being used? Our point is not about the research. Our point is, where is the utility going? You know? So they say, well, that lather on the body, you know, when you bathe, it stays longer, it feels nice. You know, for a mundane person. And people may pay money for that. The mundane. So, this is the first part of the story. Content, where is it being used? And the experience that has been created after that. Like, you know, somebody knows music. So, he can create an experience. Either elevation in consciousness or degradation. So, I have seen in ISKCON so many scholars. And you associate with them, when they give explanation of the Gita or Bhagavatam from the perspective of science and how these concepts apply there in the problems that they are stuck with, it's an amazing thing to hear, you know. So I wonder whether their scholarship went waste or did it come to right use. And we have a classic example of this, that is Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. That he was a greatest scholar, mundane scholar. And nobody could debate and argue with him for anything. Any topic under the sun you take, he can prove the thesis, prove the antithesis, then reprove the original thesis, and then again reprove the antithesis. He could do that a million times. And people will get fed up with him. What is this going on here? He wanted to prove that Nachasa Vrusheri Asya Mat. What is that? Atmasya Tattvam Nihito Guhaya Mahajano Yena Gata Sapantha. You cannot understand things by mundane scholarship. You have to take shelter of a guru, then you start understanding things. So he performed such an elaborate leela of mundane scholarship for that purpose. But later on you see the same Chaitanya Mahaprabhu uses logic. Where? With whom? Sarvam Bhattacharya. And he uses, and his, in his discussions, he uses the same technique. He gives Atma Rama Varsa, so many explanations, 64 explanations, 29 explanations, 27 explanations. 61. But now for what purpose? To convince a hardcore Mayavadi and a Jnani to become a Bhakta. He speaks in his language, what he understands. So I don't think Sarvam Bhattacharya Adur would have bought in the whole thing. Because he was still thinking these are all sentimental people. They don't know anything that they are doing. So this is the purpose. So one should have this vision of how to connect things to Krishna. Then one is allowed. And if you don't have that vision, you better go to those persons who can teach you how to use that field of human endeavor in that direction. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, you are doing self-development, you are doing people development, you are doing organizational development using that knowledge. So is that knowledge being properly utilized? It is being properly utilized to the degree those people and those organizations and you add value and elevate people's consciousness. If you just treat their bodies, give them some mental, you know, satisfactions and leave them, then it will remain material. On another side, we should not neglect our upkeep in spiritual direction. You know, how often should men shave? Depends on the frequency of how fast your hair grow. You know, similarly, how often should we chant? How often should we read? How often should we keep ourselves clean in consciousness? Depends on at what rate your material desires are increasing in your heart. If it is too much, then you have to do little too much. You know, so you have to, that side also should be kept alive. Not that we do only one thing. Then we are safe in whatever we are offering. Okay. So now begins this yogi who from Arurukshu will go to Arudha stage, and he has to do certain arrangements for that. There are external arrangements and then there are internal arrangements. External arrangements refer to the setting, the scenario, you know, artifacts. Then bodily arrangements, sitting postures, etc. Then there are internal arrangements, lifestyle, attitude, and also especially the very practice of elevating consciousness from matter to spirit. So that will be described now onwards. Yogi yunjita satatam atmanam rahasi sthitaha ekake yata cittatma nirashira parigraha.
A transcendentalist should always engage his body, mind and self in realization with the Supreme. He should live alone in the secluded place and should always carefully control his mind. He should be free from desires and feelings of possessiveness.
So, satatam is a very critical factor. Whichever yoga practice you may take, the second paragraph in the purport. Nevertheless, all of these includes Brahman, Paramatma and Bhagavan feature practitioners. They are all instructed herewith to be constantly engaged in their particular pursuits so that they may come to the highest perfection sooner or later. The first business is to keep mind on Krishna. Yogi yunjita satatam. In order to concentrate the mind, one should always remain in seclusion and avoid disturbance by external objects. Rahasi sthitaha. He should be very careful to accept favorable and reject unfavorable. Yata Chittatma. Constantly endeavoring. And in perfect determination, he should not hanker after unnecessary material things that entangle him by feelings of possessiveness. So how do material things entangle us? By creating feelings of possessiveness. We don't own them, but suddenly something happens. We start thinking, ye mera hai. So you remember we in Nectar of Instruction, we had done this joy of less long back. You know, elaborate on how you should go home and streamline your household under four categories. What are they? Useful stuff, beautiful stuff, emotional stuff, and unused or useless stuff. And then you do trash, treasure, transfer, and temporarily undecided. Four piles. Trash, you know, neither value to me nor value to others. Trash. Let's say you took only one locker or one kitchen or one whatever area of your house. So trash. Then treasure. Things that are of value to me. I want to keep them. I have been using them regularly and I use them frequently. Then transfer. Things that are of no value to me anymore, but they are of value to others. So transfer. Either put it on OLX or just donate. Donate to temple, donate to some worthy cause. So that is transfer. And then still some things remain, we don't know what to do with them. So that is temporarily undecided. You put them in a bunch, box, put them aside, out of sight, out of mind. And if in the next 6 months you didn't take any particular object out of that to use it in day-to-day basis, then that becomes transfer pile. Not trash, transfer. So you get it? This is called, one should not hanker after unnecessary material things that entangle him by feelings of possessiveness. This is, we need perfect determination for that. You know that Japanese haiku, when my house burned down, I had a better view of the rising moon. Lord Chaitanya's moon is rising. Oh, it's not at all surprising. We are chanting in the streets, telling everyone you meet, we are going home. So that moon of Lord Chaitanya, Nishkinchanasya Bhagavad Bhajanon Mukhasya. To become Bhagavad Bhajana Unmukha, you need a little bit of Nishkinchanata, non-possessiveness. Or that verse, Tvam Akinchana Gocharam. O Krishna, you are only visible to those who are materially exhausted, materially impoverished, who have no feelings of possessiveness over material things. To them you become visible. So you have a better view of the rising moon, Vrindavan Chandra. When your house burns down. Sorry, not in that tone, but you minimize your extra wagons in life. Should we trash, treasure, transfer, or temporarily undecide? What do we do with kids? For each family member. That's neither adding value to my life nor can I add trash. Oh, Hare Krishna.
Transfer. Give it to somebody. Temple. Take it.
Give them to temple. This is a classic thing that happens in our management. Some call comes. Swami ji, ek gaadi hai, mandir ko dena chahte hai. And now, earlier we were really poor. We had nothing. So we used to think, are such a grand thing, you know, somebody is giving away. And we have got such horrible experiences with the car that people send here. You know, nothing works. And the maintenance is more than the running. You know, and the parts that are supposed to make basic functions, you know, they make you function, you know. For God knows what reasons. You know. So nowadays we don't dive only. So udhari gaadi rakho pehle, hum aake udhar dekhte. Chala ke wagera. Fir baad mein lenge. Anyways. So going to her question, what to do with family members? And kids especially. Should we have possessiveness over them? Or should we be detached from them? Prabhupada replies this, one should be affectionate but not attached. Which means, we do what we need to do to fulfill their needs and values without breaking dharma. Not necessarily Krishna conscious principles. Dharma, ordinary dharma in the household. And we express that through loving service and loving dealings, always. Even if they are not Krishna conscious. This is a very context specific question, because who they are, what they are doing, what's your Krishna consciousness. Sometimes our idea of Krishna consciousness is also very otherworldly, you know. So, but in general, we should develop this ability to speak kind words candidly. That I cannot do because I have another priority right now. No questions asked. You can become upset about it, then we sort that out later. But so this is a matter of training, how we should address their needs and values without compromising our needs and values in life. Okay. Now, so Yukta Vairagya, Prabhupada starts describing, and that is in the context of Nirashi and Aparigraha. These two words are explained by that two verses, Phalgu Vairagya, Yukta Vairagya verses quoted in the purport. We have done this a million times, so I am not, million means as a saying it. I wish we could have done this million times. But last paragraph, Krishna conscious person, he comes everywhere. No purports generally misses him out. You know, well known that everything belongs to Krishna, and thus he is always free from feelings of, you are the answer. As such, he has no hankering for anything on his personal account. He knows how to accept things in favor of Krishna consciousness, how to reject things unfavorable. He is always aloof from material things because he is always transcendental. He is always alone, having nothing to do with persons not in Krishna consciousness. Always alone. Therefore, this Krishna conscious person is a perfect yogi. Okay. Now comes some setting to be arranged for Ashtanga Yoga. Shuchau deshe pratishthapya sthiram asanam atmanah. Natyuchritam nati nicham chailajina kushottaram. Tatraikagram manah krutva yata chittendriya kriyaha. Upavishyasane yunjat yogam atma vishuddhaye. So to practice yoga. Yogam. For what purpose? Atma vishuddhaye. For the purpose of purifying one's heart. What should one do? One should go to a secluded place. So that secluded is not exactly there, but shuchau, sanctified place is there. Because that secluded is coming from the previous one, rahasi sthitaha. It's actually sacred place you should go to, shuchau deshe. Then pratishthapya, placing oneself in sthiram asanam. One should lay kushagras on the ground. Kusha uttaram, and then cover it with deer skin, ajina, and then cover that with a soft cloth, chaila. The seat should be neither too high nor too low, na ati utchritam, na ati nicham, and should be situated in a sacred place, shuchau deshe. The yogi should then sit on it very firmly, sthiram asanam. And practice yoga to purify the heart, atma vishuddhaye, by controlling his mind, yata chitta, and activities of the senses, yata indriya kriyaha. And one should fix the mind on one point, eka agra manaha krutva. There is a particular type of grass that grows straight, and its roots are very powerful. They have, so they uproot the kusha grass and they point the roots towards the east and sit on it. for meditation. It has a all this pranic healing and spiritual, what you call, favorable environment creation ability. So that's Kushagras. Violence, huh? Yeah, generally, sometimes deers die also naturally. Sometimes that skin is rejected because of the ferocious animals ate them.
What is the scientific reason?
The deer skin rejects reptiles and insects. Vyaghra charma, Mruga charma, they repel. This is no crabs or snakes. They don't come on the. When you asana, you are sitting. There are some insects, they don't climb on that. So that's the reason. Technology. Yeah, this is very difficult. First of all, to get a deer skin only is difficult. So Prabhuji is not waiting till the end of the chapter. He's rejecting the yoga process right away. He says, I don't want to practice this. So Prabhupada tells which are the sacred places to go. Don't stay in big cities. And in Kali Yuga, Harer Nama, Harer Nama, Harer Nama, Yuva Kevalam. Kalo Nasti Eva, Nasti Eva. Atiranyata. Okay. Samam Kaya Shiro Grivam Dharayan Achalam Sthiraha. Sampreksha Nasikagram Swam Dishaschan Anavalokayan. Prashantatma Vigatabhir Brahmachari Vrate Sthitaha Manasam Yam Yamat Chitto Yukta Asi Tamat Paraha. So this is bodily postures, beginning of description of asana and then pranayama eventually. So one should hold one's body, neck and head erect in one straight line. Samam Kaya Shiro Grimam. Kaya, body, Shiro, head, Griva, neck. Samam Dharayan, hold it in that position. Achalam Sthiraha, don't move. So these are helpful in Japa also. Sitting erect like this helps one to concentrate immediately. And then Samprekshan Asikagram. Look at your tip of the nose. And Dishaha cha anavalokayan. Don't do radar japa. Periodically scanning the environment. That devotee came in. He took the bottle, drank the water, kept it down, put the board. Are tum apna japa karo. You know, so we are like, you know, we are conscious of everything that is happening around us other than the chanting. So that is why Dishascha Anavalokayan. Don't look here and there. Then Prashantatma. Subdued, remain unagitated. Subdued mind. Manas Samyamya. Vigatabhi, devoid of fear. You see Dhruva Maharaj, small boy going in jungle. What do you want? I want to achieve Vishnu. I say, going in jungle. Yeah, so many dangerous animals there. Don't get into details. Tell me the essence. What's the point? How can we achieve Vishnu? That's the only question that he's asking. Vigatabhi, devoid of fear. Nowadays, of course, addition to the ferocious animals, there are Virappan and other people type, you know, sitting inside the jungle. So it becomes even more dangerous. And Brahmachari Vrate Sthitaha, completely free from sex life. Very critical point of Ashtanga Yoga. Sex life and yoga, Ashtanga Yoga, go ill together. So, Grihasthas are already boycotted from the practice. Grihastha, Vanaprastha, so on. And then, Manaha Samyamya Mat Chittaha. Now, you see, Krishna, he is giving the hint of this Ishvara Pranidhana by making that yogi meditate on himself. So, Mat Chittaha. Thus, yukta asita matparaha. One should meditate upon me within the heart and make me the ultimate goal of life. Matpara. And still, yogis don't teach this. These are initial stages. So, if you remember, we did this Yama Niyama, I was elaborating them last time. Do's and don'ts. So don'ts are, you know, satya, himsa, satya, asteya, brahmacharya, aparigraha. So we saw them. Those terms had come, no? Aparigraha and brahmacharya, etc. Then niyama, do's, what are they? Tapas, santosha, svadhyaya, ishvara, pranidhana and tapaha, santosha, shaucha, svadhyaya and ishvara, pranidhana. These are niyama. You are supposed to do them. Do tapasya, be satisfied, always be clean, shaucha. And ishvara pranidhana, meditate on the Supreme Lord. So yukta asita matparaha. So all these yama and niyama are covered here. And then a bit of asana is also covered. Which tip it is?
Is this tip or the other
tip? Tip, tip.
This point or this point, I mean, I feel little pain.
But who told you?
Because that says it will improve your concentration or something, so I'm not...
Yeah, you see, eyesight, na, as soon as you focus your eyes on a particular limb of your body, where attention goes, energy flows. So even in pranayama, even in other asanas, you are actually taught, like, you know, you do tadasana. So you are supposed to look upward. Then you do whatever. So the eyesight has a connection with where you want to send the energy. Now here the whole thing is about anavalokayan. Don't look here and there. There are more things to come. This is not the whole thing. But this is the beginning of not becoming distracted. Then Drupad gives definition of brahmacharya. Karmana manasa vacha sarvavasthasu sarvada sarvatra maithuna tyago brahmacharyam prachakshate. To abstain from sex indulgence in work, karmana, words, manasa, sorry, vacha and mind, manasa. At all times, sarvada, under all circumstances, sarvavasthasu and in all places, sarvatra. Maithuna tyagaha. And then comes my USP. No one can perfect correct yoga practice through sex indulgence. Brahmacharya is taught therefore from childhood and when one has no knowledge of sex life. Children at the age of 5 are sent to Gurukula, the place of spiritual master. And the master trains the young boys in strict disciplines of becoming brahmacharis. Without such practice, no one can make advancement in any yoga. So all Dhyana Yogi, Ashtanga Yogi and Jnana Yogi and Bhakti Yogi are supposed to send their children to Gurukula. Little later, in the Bhakti school, householder Brahmachari is allowed, controlled sex life. Because Bhakti Yoga is so powerful that one automatically loses sexual attraction. Being engaged in superior service of the Lord. Vishaya Vinivartante. One becomes detached from Vishaya. Niraharasya dehinaha. Although one has supposed to be shutting off the senses from their supply, ahara. But rasavarjam rasopi asya. There is taste for sense objects, but still one does not indulge in taking rasa out of them. Why? Param drushtva nivartate. He has seen Param, the Supreme, and thus nivartate. Nivartate is like turning your back to it. Like you are going on the street and you see some Ajamila sight. Ajamila saw the sight. Then you turn your back to it. That's called Nivartate. Param drushtva Nivartate. And then Prabhupada gives a classic explanation for Vigata Bhi. How to become fearless. Where does Bhaya come from? Bhayam Dvitiya Abhiniveshataha Syat. Ishadapetasya viparyayo asmurtihi. As soon as you turn your face away from Krishna, what comes in picture is fear in life. Just like a child who leaves the safe, secure hands of his parents and wants to go out and explore the street or the world around. As soon as he steps out like that, without the shelter of the parents, everything becomes fearful. So bhayam. Dvitiya abhinivesha means absorption in things other than Krishna consciousness is the cause of fear, bhaya. Then again that Krishna conscious person comes. He is already the best of all yogis. Because he is also practicing all this in real life. Prashantatma, Vigatabhi, Brahmachari, Vrate Stitaha. But much more naturally, much more easily. Last verse for the day. Yunjanevam sadatmanam yogi niyatamanasaha shantim nirvana paramam mat samstham adhigacchati. See, so clear. Yoga practice is aimed at mat chittaha, mat paraha, mat samstham adhigacchati. Now what remains to be told to a yogi? But still there are bogus yoga institutions that don't even mention these things anywhere. So that's our anger. So shantim nirvana paramam, Prabhupada explains that nirvana, nor does cessation of material existence, fifth line, entails one entering into the void, which is only a myth. There is no void anywhere in the creation of the Lord, except in the head of atheistic scientists. That is shunya. There is no brain substance there. Or in the head of some bogus spiritualists who claim anything other than Krishna consciousness as the goal of yoga practice. Rather, the cessation of material existence, nirvana paramam, enables one to enter into spiritual sky, mat samstham. Krishna ki samstha hai udhar. Hare Krishna samstha. And thus, the abode of the Lord is clearly described. Which one? Natat bhasayate suryo na shashanko na pavakaha yad gatva na nivartante mrutyu samsara vartmani. Next paragraph. A consummate yogi who is perfect in understanding Lord Krishna, mat chittaha, mat paraha, mat sthanam, can attain real peace, shantim, and can ultimately reach his supreme abode, Krishna lok, Golok Vrindavan. A 6th, 7th line from the bottom. Therefore, a person working in Krishna consciousness is a perfect yogi because his mind is always absorbed in Krishna activities. Savai manaha. Tam eva viditva ati mrutyum eti. Tam eva means knowing that supreme Lord. Viditva. What happens? Ati mrutyum. You cross over death and you go back to Godhead. Last line. In other words, perfection of the yoga system is the attainment of freedom from material existence and not some magical jugglery or gymnastic feats to befool innocent people. Same applies to our practice of Krishna consciousness, especially chanting, that yunjan eva sada atmanam. Try and chant constantly. Yogi niyata manasaha. Try and control your mind from going here and there and 100 directions. Shantim. Become peaceful. And thus mat samstham adhigachyati. I just visited recently Gaur Govind Prabhu's parents in Nigdi. And his father has developed an amazing taste. He sits and keeps writing Sitaram, Radhesham, Harikshita Mantra on, and there are diaries after diaries after diaries filled by him. Whole day. He's old person. His participation in home matters is only to greet Vaishnavas or to give them a proper reception, or never speaks much. And always writes her mantra. Whole day. Can you imagine somebody doing that for like 12, 13 hours a day? Nothing else. Such absorption. So this is the symptom of mat samstham adhigacchati. You know, such a person. Powerful. Okay. Any comments or questions? Thank you very much. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.